the parties, are we waiting for anyone? Claimants, are we waiting for anyone on your side? No? Respondents?
We're ready.
Ms. Chavez, welcome. You have a witness declaration in front of you. I'd be grateful if you could read that into the record, please.
Sí, señor. Declaro solemnemente por mi honor y conciencia que diré la verdad, toda la verdad y solo la verdad.
Thank you very much. Respondents?
We're going to pass out some binders right now, and then I'll ask you a few questions, Ms. Chavez. Could you please look behind tab one of the binder in front of you?
Sí, señora.
Do you recognize this document?
Sí, señora, es mi declaración testimonial escrita.
Is that statement based on your personal knowledge and experience?
Sí, señora.
Are there any corrections that you would like to make to your witness statement?
Básicamente quiero hacer tres precisiones. En el párrafo 47, en la segunda frase debe eliminarse las palabras "el juez le solicita al", porque la frase se debe leer de forma correcta de la siguiente forma: una vez que el juzgado emite sentencia en firme sobre el justiprecio, el Estado debe realizar la transferencia de los fondos a la cuenta del juzgado. Esto es porque en algunas ocasiones el juez solicita la transferencia y en otros no. La segunda precisión tiene que ver con la nota al pie de página 93, en tanto se citó el artículo 693 del Código Civil de Costa Rica, pero lo correcto es el artículo 693 del Código Procesal Civil de Costa Rica. Y la última precisión es en el cuadro resumen, en la última página de la declaración, donde viene el resumen de estado de procesos judiciales de expropiación, en la primera casilla, referente al lote A, por error se puso que se inició en el 2017 y evidentemente es un error material porque fue en el 2007. Eso sería básicamente.
Thank you. And for the record, the civil procedure code is at exhibit R002. Where are you currently working?
En la Procuraduría General de la República.
What is your current position?
Soy procuradora adjunta.
For how long have you held this position?
Desde el año 2004.
Could you please describe the work that you do in the office of La Procuraduría?
Nosotros somos los abogados del Estado. En mi caso específico, represento al Estado, ya sea en procesos interpuestos por el Estado en contra de terceros o en procesos que interponen terceros en contra del Estado. Esa es básicamente mi función.
Could you please describe your educational background?
Sí, señora. Tengo una licenciatura en Derecho de la Universidad de Costa Rica, una especialización en Derecho Público de la misma universidad, de la Universidad de Costa Rica, una maestría en Derecho de McGill University de Montreal, Canadá, y estudios varios en el campo del derecho.
Could you please explain briefly the judicial stage of the expropriation proceedings in Costa Rica?
Sí, señora. Bueno, básicamente, inicialmente hay una declaración de interés público y se realiza un avalúo administrativo en la que se fija el justiprecio del bien o el valor justo de la propiedad. Y si existe objeción por parte del propietario, en contra de ese avalúo es que se pasa a la etapa judicial. Lo primero que se hace es que se emite un decreto expropiatorio que lo emite el Poder Ejecutivo, específicamente el Ministerio de Ambiente y Energía, y se deposita el dinero del avalúo administrativo en la cuenta del juzgado. Posteriormente, bueno, esto se remite a la Procuraduría General, que establece la demanda y la interpone ante el juzgado contencioso administrativo. Inicia el proceso judicial. El proceso judicial consiste única y exclusivamente en la revisión del avalúo administrativo. En este proceso se caracteriza por respetar el derecho de defensa y el debido proceso. Se nombra un perito judicial que tiene como función revisar el avalúo administrativo. Las partes también pueden solicitar el nombramiento de un perito tercero en discordia. Las partes pueden aportar toda aquella prueba que consideren relevante para determinar el valor del bien. Finalmente, cuando se ha evacuado la prueba, se le ha dado audiencia a las partes sobre toda la prueba que consta en el expediente, se dicta la sentencia. La sentencia, bueno, la ley establece que el valor del bien no puede ser inferior al avalúo administrativo ni superior al monto del avalúo judicial o al monto más alto de los avalúos judiciales si se hicieron dos avalúos judiciales, y esta sentencia tiene recurso de apelación.
What happens if an expropriation decree has not been issued within a year's time of when a declaration of public interest has been registered?
Caduca de oficio de conformidad con la ley.
Were you the lawyer in charge of all of the judicial proceedings in the lot of the lots in this case?
Únicamente en seis de ellos he sido la representante legal, y en algunos de ellos no he tenido la representación durante todo el proceso, sino solo sobre parte del proceso.
And do you recall which ones you have overseen?
Déjeme ver, aquí tengo la... Sí, el A40... El B3, B5, B6, B7 y B8.
Have you reviewed the judicial files for the other proceedings?
Lo revisé para este proceso arbitral, básicamente.
Have there been any updates since you wrote your last witness statement?
En el lote A40 ya se pagaron los intereses legales adeudados. En el lote B3 existe decisión en firme sobre los intereses legales. En el lote B5 existe sentencia en firme. Y en el lote B7 existe sentencia, pero que fue apelada por la Procuraduría General. Sentencia sobre la indemnización.
And one final question. Could you please summarize the current status of the properties at issue in this case that are currently in or have been through the judicial proceedings?
Sí, señora. En este caso tenemos 9 procesos judiciales. De esos, en 6 ya hay sentencia firme, 2 están suspendidos a solicitud de la parte expropiada y 1 está en apelación. La sentencia está en apelada. De los 6 que tenemos sentencia en firme, hay 2 en los que ya se realizó el pago de la indemnización que se adeuda al propietario de conformidad con la ley de expropiaciones, y los otros 4 el pago está en trámite. Eso sería de forma general.
Thank you very much. I have no further questions.
Thank you. Ms. Chiquetti.
Thank you, Mr. President. Welcome, Ms. Chavez. My name is Tina Cicchetti. We've been in the same room all week, but I don't think we've introduced ourselves to each other. I'll be asking you a few questions on behalf of the claimants this afternoon. For the record, I'll note that the claimants had not noticed Ms. Chavez for cross-examination, but since she has come all the way here, we will ask her a few questions. I note that your witness statement says that you have worked at the Procuraduría since 2001. Is that correct?
Sí, señora.
But I just noticed in your direct examination, in response to Ms. McCandless's question, you've said that you've been in your position, current position, since 2004. Does that mean that you were in a different position when you first started with the Procuraduría in 2001?
Empecé en el año 2001 como asistente de procuradora y de procuraduría y me nombraron procuradora adjunta en el año 2004.
And I suggest to you that when you joined the Procuraduría's office in 2001, there were very few, if any, expropriations related to the Las Balas National Marine Park at that time. Would you agree?
No sabría contestarle porque en ese entonces, es más, si bien recuerdo, entré a trabajar con una procuradora que se encargaba únicamente de consultas y después pasé al campo del litigio. Entonces, en realidad, es una información que no conozco.
Okay. And you've given evidence in this proceeding, direct evidence in response to a number of lots where you are personally involved for the claimant's lots and for the others you've reviewed the files, correct?
Sí, señora, los que revisé fue para este proceso arbitral, básicamente. Son expedientes de más de 1,000 folios. Así que.
And you've also reviewed any updates since you filed your last witness statement, as you've just indicated.
Sí, señora.
Okay, thank you. I have a few questions about the expropriation process. MINAI is the government ministry responsible for issuing the expropriation decree, correct?
Sí, señora, el acuerdo de expropiación.
And at paragraph 4 of your witness statement, you say, the court may order that the property enter into the state's possession if it has been more than 2 months since the deposit of the amount of the administrative appraisal. See that?
Sí, pero eso es una vez iniciado el proceso judicial. Una vez iniciado el proceso judicial, y que se encuentre depositado el avalúo administrativo, entonces se puede ordenar la entrada en posesión por parte del Estado, pero es el juez verifica que el monto del avalúo administrativo esté depositado en el juzgado porque ese dinero le pertenece al propietario del bien.
Thank you, I take that clarification. My question is, does the court order dispossession on its own motion, or is it the Procuraduría who requests possession of the property on behalf of the state?
La ley dice que una vez que se inicia el proceso judicial, se emite la resolución de inicio. El propietario tiene 2 meses para desalojar y si no lo hace, el juzgado ordena la entrada en posesión. Se fija fecha para la entrada en posesión por parte del Estado.
And I'm still at paragraph 4 of your witness statement, but now on the last sentence. And it says, with the state taking possession of the property owner loses possession of the property, but not the property itself. So once a property owner has been dispossessed, the owner has no rights to use and enjoy the property, but they don't lose title to the property, correct?
Si no, no pierde el título de la propiedad, pierde la posesión, el uso, el disfrute. Su derecho queda limitado, Por eso es que de previo tiene que hacerse un avalúo administrativo y ese avalúo tiene que depositarse en el juzgado como una especie de pago previo, preliminar, por el proceso.
But a property owner who has been dispossessed of his or her property continues to have obligations related to the property, such as the obligation to pay property taxes, correct?
Sí, señora. Tengo entendido que sí.
And is it possible that the date of dispossession changes in some of the proceedings?
Ocurrió el caso de que todos los lotes B fueron tramitados por un abogado que impugnó todas las resoluciones de entrada en posesión. En esos casos él interpuso recurso de revocatoria con apelación en subsidio. El recurso fue rechazado por el juez de primera instancia, entonces posteriormente interpuso recursos de apelación por inadmisión. Y por los efectos de los recursos y según la resolución del juez, se indicó que la entrada en posesión iba a tener efecto a partir del momento en que se resolvieran estos recursos. Sin embargo, esto, si no me equivoco, se dio solo en uno de esos casos. Si no me equivoco, tendría que revisar los documentos y no estoy segura que sea dentro de los casos de este proceso porque llevo más procesos judiciales relacionados con expropiaciones. Si tiene algún documento que enseñarme, lo veo y entonces le respondo con más certeza.
Thank you. The I take your answer to my last question to mean that it is possible that the date of dispossession changes.
Y lo que tendríamos que ver es en estos casos qué pasó en cada caso específico por la situación específica de que la representación de todos los lotes B interpuso estos recursos que le estoy diciendo, además de múltiples incidentes de nulidad, entonces yo tendría que revisar los documentos para ver y decirle específicamente qué pasó en cada caso.
All right.
Yo llevo 500 expedientes y usted comprenderá que no me los sé todo desde memoria, ¿no?
Absolutely. My question was meant to be general, Ms. Chavez. I wasn't trying to test your memory specifically.
Bueno, pero podemos, si lo que nos interesa en este caso es ver la situación específica de los propietarios afectados, necesito referirme a los casos específicos, ¿no?
Perhaps I can just ask it as a general question. Is it or is it not possible that the date of dispossession can change?
Ya le contesté esa pregunta.
Thank you. In terms of the overall judicial expropriation process, dispossession is not the final step, is it?
No, señora, es de los primeros pasos que hay, porque como ya lo expliqué, se inicia el proceso judicial, el propietario tiene 2 meses para desalojar. Si no desaloja y si está depositado el avalúo administrativo, el juez pone en posesión al Estado.
And for 5 of 9 of the lots that you discuss in your witness statements, lots A40, SPG 2, B3, B6, and B8, your witness statements say that the judicial proceeding has been completed. What do you say is the final step in the judicial expropriation process?
Bueno, en términos generales, se puede hacer el traspaso del título de propiedad cuando existe una sentencia en firme sobre el monto de la indemnización.
Ms. Chavez, you were in the room earlier when we were talking about the possibility of annulling title. What happens if title is annulled?
En estos casos, que yo tenga conocimiento, no existe ningún proceso de nulidad que se esté siguiendo contra estos propietarios. O sea, lo que existe es un proceso de expropiación que estableció el Estado en virtud de su poder de imperio y por existir un parque nacional para precisamente en el que lo que se está discutiendo es única y exclusivamente el valor de la propiedad.
Moving to a different topic. This is just a point of clarification for me, if you don't mind, Ms. Chavez. If we look at your witness statement at paragraphs 3, 5, and 10, there's a slight difference between the English translation and the Spanish original, and I just want to confirm. In the English translation, it alternatively refers to fair market value and fair value. And it appears that the Spanish version consistently uses the term justi precio. I just wanted to confirm whether you meant that term to have the same meaning throughout your witness statement.
Sí, señora.
Thank you.
La ley de expropiación les habla sobre el valor justo, sobre el precio justo o justiprecio.
And you've explained in your witness statement that fair value is determined in the expropriation process through a series of valuations, correct?
No, señora, yo dije que en primer lugar, se realiza un avalúo administrativo. En este avalúo administrativo se determina el precio justo que considera el Estado. Este precio, este valor, este avalúo puede ser o no aceptado por el propietario. Hay muchas ocasiones en que los propietarios aceptan los avalúos administrativos. Si el propietario no está de acuerdo con ese avalúo administrativo, con ese valor, entonces el Estado procede a interponer el proceso judicial en el que lo que se hace es que se revisa el avalúo administrativo y se determina el valor final. Es una competencia del juez determinar el justiprecio o valor del bien o indemnización, sea como sea que lo llamemos.
So you would agree that the goal of the judicial process is to arrive at a fair value for the property, correct?
Sí, señora.
And on what basis does the court determine the valuation date for the properties?
En esto existen dos criterios. La ley dice que se debe valorar el bien al momento en que fue evaluado. Y sin embargo, existe otro criterio jurisprudencial que indica que debe ser el valor actual. O sea, no al momento en que fue evaluado en el avalúo administrativo, sino posteriormente al momento de dictarse sentencia.
Ms. Chavez, I heard you to just say that the administrative appraisal provides the state's view of what the fair value is for the property. Did I hear you correctly?
El avalúo administrativo es hecho por la Dirección General de Tributación Directa. Es un departamento que se dedica a hacer avalúos. Entonces, es el valor que se establece en vía administrativa del valor del bien.
And then if the owner opposes or objects to that appraisal, then it moves over to the judicial process. And you've explained that through that process, there are a number of appraisals where a judge determines fair value. Would you agree with me that this is an adversarial process?
Sí, señora. Una vez, siempre y cuando se haya emitido el decreto expropiatorio por parte del Poder Ejecutivo. Este es el presupuesto para iniciar el proceso judicial.
I'm just going to pose my question one more time, Ms. Chavez, just to make sure that I've got your answer.
No soy doctora. Okay.
Pardon me, doctora.
Okay.
The judicial process where the Procuraduría presents appraisals and the owner proposes other appraisals and a judge eventually makes a determination of fair value. Would you agree with me that that is an adversarial process?
Sí, señora.
And would you agree that the goal of the Procuraduría in that adversarial process is to reduce the amount of compensation that needs to be paid for the property?
No, señora. Reducirlo no. Ya el Estado emitió un avalúo administrativo que no se puede reducir. Lo que se puede es aumentar. Y en estos procesos lo que se ha demostrado es que se les ha pagado muchísimo más de lo que se les otorgó en vía administrativa. O sea, han sacado ventaja de los procesos. Y ventaja no solo en el principal, sino que en los intereses legales que establece la ley, porque la ley establece que deben recibir intereses legales desde el momento de la entrada en posesión hasta el momento del efectivo pago. Y como verán, estos procesos han tenido una duración, pues, una determinada duración que implica que el monto de intereses es alto y además de eso pueden cobrar costas sobre principal e interés.
Indirect examination, doctora. Ms. McCandless asked you what happens in the event that a decree of expropriation is not issued within a year of the decree of public interest. And I understood your answer to be that it expires. Is that correct?
Sí, señora, caduca de oficio, deja de tener valor.
Your witness statement specifically addresses properties that are in the judicial phase of expropriation. Are you aware that the claimants have a number of other lots that are not currently in the judicial phase?
No, señora. Bueno, en el transcurso de la audiencia y por los comentarios que hemos tenido, pues sé que hay asuntos en vía administrativa, pero yo única y exclusivamente me ocupo de la defensa del Estado en el proceso judicial. Entonces, yo lo que conozco y de lo que le puedo hablar es de los procesos judiciales.
You were telling us earlier about the date of dispossession and the effect of dispossession. And my question relates to interest. At paragraph 49 of your witness statement, you explain that interest is recognized from the time of the entry of the property into the possession of the state. So you would agree with me that no interest is calculated or payable until the date of dispossession?
¿Me puede repetir la pregunta porque no la entiendo, por favor?
At paragraph 49 of your witness statement, you explain that interest is recognized from the time of entry of the property into the possession of the state. My question is, it's true, isn't it, that no interest is calculated until the date of dispossession?
Es que me está hablando, no entiendo la pregunta, pero voy a explicar lo referente a los intereses legales. Porque hay intereses legales e intereses corrientes. Una vez que se deposita el avalúo administrativo, ese avalúo en la cuenta del juzgado se pertenece al propietario y genera intereses corrientes. En el momento en que decida retirarlo, él lo puede retirar en cualquier momento una vez iniciado el proceso, entonces él retira ese avalúo y puede solicitar el pago de los intereses corrientes. Como perjuicios, la ley establece en su artículo 11 el reconocimiento de intereses legales. Y los intereses, eso es un reconocimiento como de daños y perjuicios. Y esos intereses legales se reconocen desde la fecha de entrada en posesión hasta el efectivo pago de la indemnización. Porque lógicamente que hay todo un proceso judicial. Entonces, si hay una diferencia entre el avalúo administrativo y la indemnización final, será cuando se pague esa fecha final que se podrá hacer el cálculo de intereses, no antes. Es imposible.
So in the expropriation process, one commences the calculation of interest if there is a difference between the final valuation and the administrative appraisal on that difference from the date of dispossession, correct?
¿Me puede repetir la pregunta, por favor?
Within the expropriation process, not the legal process that you were just discussing, one commences the calculation of interest. If there is a difference between the final valuation and the administrative appraisal, if the final valuation is higher, interest is calculated on that difference in value from the date of dispossession, correct?
Los intereses legales, sí, lógicamente, si hay una confirmación del avalúo administrativo, el avalúo administrativo ya estaba depositado y estaba depositado en favor del propietario y el propietario lo podía retirar desde el momento del inicio del proceso, porque el avalúo administrativo se deposita desde antes. Si no le retira es por voluntad propia.
My question was not about the interest payable on the administrative appraisal, so let me try to clean that up a bit. If at the end of the judicial process, a final valuation is determined, which is higher than the amount of the administrative appraisal, in the expropriation process, interest is payable only from the date of dispossession, correct?
El interés legal corre a partir de la fecha de disposición por disposición expresa de la ley. Sí, señora, y hasta el efectivo pago, creo que ya lo había dicho.
All right. If we can look at one or two examples together, please, and if you could turn to Annex A to your witness statement. Doctora, I take it that you prepared this chart?
Esto lo preparé con la ayuda de los abogados en forma conjunta.
And the figures and dates in this chart reflect the testimony in your witness statement, is that correct?
Sí, señora.
And as far as you know, the chart is accurate, at least to the date of your witness statement. Is that correct?
Que yo lo sepa, sí. Ahora, al inicio hice referencia a la actualización de cuatro puntos.
Yes, sorry. I'm just referring to the date of your witness statement, so I recognize that there may have been changes to this since the date of your witness statement. But if, since your last answer was yes, I'm just going to save a bit of time rather than flipping through your witness statement. We can just work through the example from the chart. So if we start with the top line in the chart for lot A40, the date for the calculation of interest. So this would be the date that the amount of interest was calculated, correct?
No le entiendo la pregunta.
I'm
Mr. Kedic, just before you continue, may I just ask both to you and to the witness, when you've finished asking your question and you're waiting for a response, and to the witness, when you've responded and waiting for a question, could you turn your microphones off, please, because we seem to be getting feedback, which is making it difficult for the interpreters.
Doctora Chavez, I'm just trying to understand the titles at the top of your chart at the moment. So if we're looking at the top line, the example that I want to look at is for A40.
Sí, señora, en esta tabla no hay, no se puso la fecha de la entrada en posesión. Tendría que ver los documentos para verificar cuándo fue la entrada en posesión. No hace referencia a ninguno.
Yes, I accept that. I'm looking at a slightly different issue now. I am asking about the calculation of interest. So you'll see in the third column from the right-hand side of the chart, and it's footnoted number 11, if that helps. In the English translation, it says calculation of interest. My first question is just a clarification that that calculation, that the dates that appear in that column are the dates on which the court calculates the amount of interest that is owing. Is that correct?
¿En cuál columna?
The third column from the right.
May I just remind you both, please turn your microphone off when you are not speaking. Please, to the witness.
La tercera columna habla, la tercera columna habla sobre la solicitud de apelación. No tiene nada que ver con el cálculo de intereses.
Sorry, it may be an issue of translation. I think that the third column in Spanish is liquidación intereses, and the translation is saying cálculo de interés, and it's not appearing on that column. That may be part of the confusion.
May I just interject here? I think, Ms. Cicchetti, you raised the question to the witness by reference to the footnote annotation, footnote 11. Maybe you could just make progress by both you and the witness recognizing where footnote 11 is noted.
Thank you for that assistance. Dr. Chavez, if you look at the footnotes in the title column, the third column from the right-hand side that in Spanish reads liquidación intereses. That's the column I'm interested in. Are you with me?
Sí, señora.
And I'm just trying to understand what that date is. Is that the date on which an owner submits a calculation of interest to the court?
Sí, señora, sería la fecha de solicitud de los intereses legales, liquidación de intereses legales. O sea, es una solicitud que, de la cual se le debe dar audiencia a la Procuraduría, la cual resuelve el juez y la cual está sujeta a recurso de apelación.
And then later there is a decision on calculation of interest, and that appears in the following column, which is footnoted number 12 in your chart. Is that correct?
Sí, señora.
And the final column is the date of the payment of interest, and that would be the date that that interest amount is put into a court account. Is that correct?
Sí, señora. Giro de intereses, aquí nos estamos refiriendo al giro de cuando el propietario lo retira.
Okay, thank you. So I just wanted to look at two examples here now that we understand what the column headings mean. For the first row, lot A40. The date of calculation of interest is June 7, 2012, correct?
Sí, señora.
And the date for the decision on calculation of interest is 17 January 2013, correct?
Sí, señora.
And the final column here has a notation in progress, but I understand that during your direct testimony, you mentioned that there was an update to lot A40 and that interest has been paid, correct?
Sí, señora.
Are the documents related to the updates that you provided in your direct testimony in the record?
Realmente no lo sé. Yo dije de lo que tengo conocimiento.
Okay, so if we can look at this chart, assuming looking at it as of the date of your witness statement, it notes that the payment of interest is in progress. Do you see that?
Sí, señora.
And can you just remind us of the date of your witness statement, please?
Veintidós de diciembre del 2014.
Okay. So from the date of the decision of calculation of interest until at least December 22nd, 2014, and after that, the interest had yet to be paid. Is that correct?
Sí, señora, pero aquí tengo que hacer varias aclaraciones. Durante ese tiempo no es que no se haya movido el expediente judicial, al mismo tiempo que la parte realizó la solicitud de intereses, solicitó una liquidación de costas. De eso se le dio audiencia al Estado y el Estado recibió una resolución en que se condenaba un monto determinado de costas y el Estado interpuso un recurso de revocatoria con apelación en subsidio en contra de esa resolución. Posteriormente, entonces, se recibe una resolución en la que se dice que se deniega el recurso interpuesto y se ordena el pago de costas e intereses. Entonces, yo en primer lugar interpongo una apelación por inadmisión ante el Tribunal Superior de forma directa en relación con lo de las costas y posteriormente interpongo un recurso de revocatoria contra el pago de intereses legales porque no me ha sido notificado. Y un principio básico es que las sentencias deben ser notificadas para conocerlas. El tribunal entra, el expediente se pasa en su totalidad al Tribunal Superior. El Tribunal Superior conoce del recurso de apelación, lo admite. Finalmente, lo vuelve a pasar al juzgado. El juzgado da audiencia a las partes sobre el recurso. Posteriormente, se pasa el expediente al Tribunal Superior, quien resuelve el recurso sobre la liquidación de costas que hizo que presentó la parte contraria. Esto se devuelve al juzgado, todo lleva un rol, todo lleva un trámite, son muchos los casos que se llevan. Cuando llega al juzgado, entonces se notifica la resolución, igualmente se notifica la resolución de giro de intereses y el Estado procede a cancelar las costas y posteriormente los intereses.
So if I understand your answer, doctora, the almost two year delay between the decision on calculation of interest and the payment of interest related to state appeals to the process?
Es un trámite normal y en todo caso tengamos en cuenta que el Código Procesal Civil de Costa Rica dice que los procesos se inician por demanda, se siguen por impulso procesal del juez y por actividad de las partes. Evidentemente, tanto el propietario como el Estado puede hacer cualquier gestión y puede presentar gestiones para que se le resuelvan solicitudes si consideran que no se les han sido resueltas. O si consideran que hay alguna una violación o algún retraso.
Thank you. If we could just work through one more example, please. I'm looking at lot SPG2 on your chart. The date of final determination of value in the judicial process was 14 December 2012, correct?
De la indemnización, sí, señora.
And the calculation of interest was submitted on 17 December 2013, correct?
Sí, señora.
And the court decided the calculation of interest on 13 August 2014, correct?
Sí, señora.
Thank you. A new topic, please. At paragraph 20 of your witness statement. At paragraph 20 of your witness statement, you begin your discussion of lot B1. And at paragraph 22, you note that the amount of the administrative appraisal was deposited in the court's account on 11 May 2006. Do you see that?
Sí, señora.
Then you state that the administrative valuation was updated on September 22nd, 2006, and a further deposit made on 16 November 2006. Would you agree with me that the administrative valuation for lot B1 must have increased between the date of the first appraisal and the second appraisal?
Bueno, eso es lo que se dice que se realizó, eso es lo que se dice. Que el avalúo administrativo fue actualizado.
And that first administrative appraisal is not in the record, is it?
No sé. No sabría decirle.
But at footnote 47 of your witness statement, you note that the first administrative appraisal for this lot was performed in March 2005. Is that correct?
Señora.
Okay. Can I ask you to turn to tab 19 in the white bundle that is in the corner of the desk in front of you there, please? And for the benefit of the record, this is Exhibit C-23A. And hopefully over the lunch hour, they've been updated to contain the English translations of the stamps for those of us in the room who do better with English than Spanish. Oh, apologize. I think I've been taken to the wrong tab. It's tab 20.
What's the exhibit number that you're looking at?
C-24A. We can perform the other exercise in Spanish, but perhaps we'll start with the English just to make it a little bit easier. So I'm sorry, doctora, if you could please go to tab 20.
Sí, señora, C24A, la traducción al inglés.
And then behind the English translation, you should have the Spanish original of the registry documents. Do you have that?
Antes, porque yo los tengo antes, no los tengo después.
Okay.
O sea, no sé si son los mismos documentos, tendría que verificarlo.
All right. In the top corner of the page, do you have the words Exhibit C-24A Spanish Original?
Sí, señora.
Okay, so we're looking at the same document. I'm just going to pause and go back to your witness statement for a moment. If you could just leave that open for a moment, because now we're talking about a slightly different lot. So I'd just like to go to your witness statement first, please.
See?
And we're looking at paragraph 23 this time, where you commence your discussion of lot B3.
Sí, señora.
And the questions will sound familiar to you. At paragraph 25, you note that the amount of the administrative appraisal was deposited in the court's account on 11 May 2006. Do you see that?
Sí, señora.
And then you state that the administrative valuation was updated 22 September 2006, and a further deposit made on 16 November 2006. See that?
Sí, señora. Las boletas de esos depósitos constan en las citas que se realizan. Si quieren, las revisamos.
No, that's fine. I just wanted to confirm.
No.
It's the same for these documents as well. And like the last administrative appraisal, do you know that the first administrative appraisal referred to for lot B3 is not in the record, is it?
Lo que consta es el avalúo del 2006, que es el avalúo actualizado. Tengo entendido, si no me falla la memoria, que el primer avalúo ni siquiera fue notificado a los propietarios. Entonces, se realizó un segundo avalúo precisamente para actualizar el valor del bien y para poder empezar el proceso judicial conforme a la ley. Entonces, no sé cuál es el problema.
I'm just trying to confirm that an administrative appraisal was performed in March 2005. Is that correct?
Bueno, ahí se indica, pero se indica que fue actualizado. Y lo que habría que ver es si ese avalúo fue notificado. Y según recuerdo, si la memoria no me falla, no hubo el avalúo que se notificó fue el del 2006, que es un avalúo actualizado.
But you're not saying that an appraisal was not conducted in March of 2005, are you?
¿Perdón?
You're not saying that an appraisal was not conducted in March 2005, are you?
Qué pena, pero no entendí. Si me lo puede repetir para oír la traducción.
I'm not asking whether the appraisal was notified. I'm asking whether there was an appraisal conducted in March of 2005.
¿Cuál es el párrafo?
Footnote 54 of your witness statement, doctora.
54, doctora.
Traducción.
It's at footnote 54 of your witness statement.
Ahí se indica muy claramente. Para este lote, el Estado realizó dos avalúos administrativos en marzo del 2005 y septiembre del 2006. El avalúo administrativo de septiembre del 2006 es el definitivo.
Thank you. Now, if you can please turn back to tab 20. We're looking at exhibit C-24A. And we've just been talking about lot B3. And this should be the catastro document for lot B3. Have you seen this document before?
Supongo que sí. En algún momento, porque como le digo, yo llevo 500 procesos judiciales y llevo varias expropiaciones más relacionadas con el Parque Nacional Marino Las Baulas. Entonces, supongo que sí lo había visto.
Okay. This document was up yesterday during the cross-examination of Mr. Berkowitz, and I believe you were in the room then as well. So I think in general, the format of these documents is familiar to you, yes?
En términos generales.
And I represent to you that this is the catastro documentation related to lot B3. And I'd just like to have you look at it with me, please. If you could start with the first in timestamp. So in the Spanish, if you go to the back of the document.
Sí, señora.
And the same for those on the English copy of the document. There's a stamp on the document that refers to a MINAE stamp that refers to the park. Do you see that?
En la parte de enfrente.
Yes.
Oficina de atención al usuario.
No, the MINAE stamp on the top left-hand side. To the left of the stamp you were just looking at.
O a la derecha. Que empieza por Ministerio de Ambiente y Energía, avisado 219-2005.
No, it looks like the stamp has four numbers above it, 4317. Doctora, I've just... You may not be on the right page. Ms. Mitrodosis is just going to come and make sure that you're on the same page of the document that I am. Please.
No están numeradas estas páginas.
I should say, Ms. Cicchetti, I'm looking at a document that has a number at the top which says 4316. So.
Sí, lo veo.
Does she have the same one?
Yeah. The document with 4317 is tab 19 in our bundles.
Thank you. Everyone has 4316 at the moment?
4316, at least in my bundle, is at tab 20. 4316 in my bundle is at tab 20. 4317 in my bundle is at tab 19.
Thank you. I hope everybody's on the same page.
Well, I think you may need to clarify a little bit because you were referring to Exhibit 20 C24A, which, as I say, in my bundle has a number 4316. The 4317 refers to Exhibit C23A. So if you could just make sure that we all understand what we're dealing with, please.
Yeah, so we should be in Exhibit C-24A, and I misread the number corresponding. So the number above the stamp should be 4316. We are on the second to last page of the Spanish.
That's fine, thank you.
For which there is an English translation at the front.
Or the stamps are at the back, the English translation is at the front.
Is at the front, exactly. So, Dottore, I'm hoping that you will be able to help us read this stamp, although I'm just realizing that the copy that I have may be a bit cut off. Are you familiar with these stamps in general?
Sí, señora.
And on the copy that you have, are you able to read the stamp?
Bueno, está cortado, pero dice que la ubicación que aparece en este plano se ubica dentro del Parque Nacional Marino Las Báulas en un 45% aproximadamente, según Decreto Ejecutivo 20518, Mirenem, del 9 de julio del 91. Y en la ley, no entiendo, y legislación conexa, para efectos catastrales, la inscripción está cortado, pero lo otro sí se lee.
Thank you. And you can see the date.
¿La fecha del sello?
The date of the stamp.
Sí, septiembre del 2002.
Thank you. And if you look at the lot depicted on that page, and then compare, now I'd like you to compare that page to the one a few pages ahead, which is going to be the registry document, the plano that's filed later. So in the Spanish, I have a stamped document in the top right-hand corner with a number 1707300. And then on the following page, we think you need to flip two pages forward. And I'm just trying to understand the difference between these two planos, please, and I'm hoping that you can help me because you're generally familiar with these documents. It appears to me that on the first plano that we looked at, where you read the stamp out, the lot is much larger than the lot depicted on the second plano. Can you see that?
Sí, señora. Curiosamente no trae la medida, porque veo que abajo no le puse esta fotocopia. Este es de 2736-77, que es el que se debió haber expropiado. Este debe ser, me imagino, que el de la finca madre, o sea, el de 7,000 y pico metros que le compró el señor Berkowitz a Corporación Hotelera Playa Tortuga, porque así lo dice.
And then the smaller lot that appears on the other map, would that relate to the portion of the lot that was eventually noticed for expropriation?
Pareciera que sí.
And on that map, there appears another Minay stamp on the right-hand side. Could I ask you to read that one, please?
Ministerio de Ambiente y Energía, visado 219-2005, con base en la ubicación que aparece en este plano, el inmueble que describe se ubica dentro del Parque Nacional Marino Las Baulas, según decreto ejecutivo 20518 MIRENEM del 9 de julio del 91 y la ley 7524 del 16 de agosto del 95, lo dispuesto en la ley forestal 7575 y legislación conexa se autoriza para efectos catastrales la inscripción de este plano.
Thank you. And the date of that stamp is what?
13 de mayo del 2005.
So the date of this stamp is just a few months after the first administrative appraisal was conducted on this lot, correct?
Pues pareciera. Pero tengo que aclarar que yo, o sea, mi representación es en la vía judicial. A mí me llega el expediente administrativo, entonces realmente, sí, aquí dice 13 de mayo del 2005 y la fecha del primer avalúo administrativo que se indicó de que, ¿cuál era la nota al pie de página que citó?
I believe it was footnote 54, doctora.
Sí, marzo del 2005, sí, señora.
Thank you. I have no further questions.
Thank you. Let's have the candles.
Let me just confer with my colleagues for a minute or two. We have no further questions.
Thank you. We have some brief questions by the tribunal. Mr. Cantor.
Buenas tardes, Doctora Chavez.
Perdón, no lo oí.
I said good afternoon, Dr. Chavez.
Buenas tardes.
As you know, I do not speak Spanish, so I will ask my questions in English. Very short questions. Article 20 of the expropriation law appears to me to say that if a definitive annotation of expropriation is not issued within 1 year after the notice of public interest and preliminary annotation, that the declaration of public interest expires automatically. Is that correct?
Sí, señora. Sí, señor, perdón. Estaba.
What is the legal consequence of the expiration of the declaration of public interest?
Que no existe ninguna anotación sobre la propiedad. O sea, la queda sin validez y sin efecto, el propietario tiene plena disposición de su propiedad.
Are you familiar with the December 2008 decision of the Constitutional Division relating to the decision of the Procurador?
Realmente, detalladamente, no. Tendría que, si me la permiten, para verla, pero realmente.
Would someone kindly remind me which tab that decision is under in the volume that she has in front of her?
We're correct, we think it's tab 9.
Tab 9 of the document, of the volume in front of you. And if you could turn to the Spanish language version.
Sí, señor.
Three pages before the end, the paragraph begins, por tanto.
Just, sorry to interrupt, I think for clarification, we're not sure that this is the, are you looking for the decision by the Supreme Court with respect to the Procuraduría's opinion?
Traducción, ¿puede repetir para?
This is the document at which I am looking. This is the document. I may have explained it incorrectly, but this is the
document you're looking for.
Correct.
Okay.
I'm sorry, you were about to say something, Doctor?
No, señor.
Okay. Do you have that page in front of you?
Sí, señor.
The first five lines under the paragraph that begins, por tanto.
Switch your microphone, please, interpreter. Your question again, please, sir.
The first five lines in the paragraph that begins, por tanto.
Sí, señor.
Are you familiar with the orders of the court that are contained in those lines?
En el inciso A.
Correct.
Sí, lo he visto.
If a notice of public interest for one of the properties that's covered by that language expires automatically, what, in your professional opinion, is the consequence for the instruction of the court in paragraph A?
Bueno, tal vez dividimos los puntos que me está preguntando. Aquí dice que se anulan todas las viabilidades ambientales otorgadas en las propiedades ubicadas dentro del Parque Nacional Marino Las Baulas y se ordena al Ministerio de Ambiente y Energía continuar de inmediato con los procesos de expropiación de tales propiedades. Esta es una resolución judicial que, si mal no recuerdo, se emite precisamente en protección del Parque Nacional. Y lo que veo que dice es que se anulan las viabilidades ambientales, pero la propiedad sigue perteneciendo al propietario y el propietario la compró con conocimiento de que estaba dentro de un parque nacional. Tan es así que, refiriéndome a la pregunta que me hizo la licenciada, en tres de los expedientes judiciales constan las escrituras en donde Berkowitz le compra a Corporación Hotelera Turnón, y en esa escritura, en la que compra 24 lotes, compra todos los lotes B por un precio de $80,000 cada uno y todos los demás por $31,000. Y en esa escritura el notario público da fe de que todos los planos catastrados cuentan con el sello del MINAE y que dice que los lotes están dentro del Parque Nacional. Pero además de eso se indica que el propietario sabe que el comprador sabe que esos lotes pueden ser sujetos a expropiación por esta situación y que renuncia a su derecho a reclamarle al vendedor. Entonces, evidentemente, esta resolución de la Sala Constitucional es una consecuencia absolutamente lógica del hecho de que estos lotes se encuentran dentro de un parque nacional.
And what is the consequence of the automatic expiration of the Declaration of Public Interest?
Según la ley, es la caducidad de oficio del decreto, del decreto en el que se hace la declaración de interés público.
Does that mean that the expropriation process must start again?
Si fuera, o sea, todo depende del caso específico. Estamos hablando hipotéticamente. Yo solo llevo los procesos judiciales. Y en todos los procesos judiciales, en los 9 procesos que yo he visto, hay una declaración de interés público y hay un decreto expropiatorio posterior y se inició el proceso judicial. Yo no le puedo hablar de los procesos administrativos porque no conozco la situación. O sea, yo solo le puedo hablar en términos generales, pues lo que dice estas primeras 5 líneas, según yo lo había leído, y lo que yo he visto en los expedientes judiciales, pero en realidad sobre la demás materia, pues en realidad no soy especialista. No sabría decirle cómo está la situación en relación con los lotes que no están sujetos al proceso judicial de expropiación.
Do you have a professional view about the impact of the expiration of the Declaration of Public Interest under the expropriation law?
O sea, la ley dice que caduca de oficio. Eso significa que esa anotación ya no tiene más efecto sobre la propiedad, que el título sigue, o sea, la propiedad sigue siendo del propietario en su pleno uso y disfrute. O sea, de hecho, hasta que no haya una anotación definitiva ya dentro del proceso judicial, o sea, ya iniciado el proceso judicial, el propietario sigue teniendo el pleno uso y disfrute. Y el título se traspasa hasta el fin, hasta cuando hay una sentencia final que fija la indemnización.
Gracias. Thank you very much.
Con mucho gusto.
Dr. Chavez, just one small point of clarification from me in the light of the questions from Mr. Cantor. And this may be in the record already, so forgive me if I have missed it. Once a declaration of public interest has been made, is an owner of property entitled to sell that property commercially?
Sí, señor.
They can sell that property commercially. This may not be within your field of expertise. I'll ask the question in any event. Would you expect there to be reduction in the value, the price of that property once a declaration of public interest has been made, if the owner sought to sell it commercially?
Todo depende del caso específico. Actualmente, todo depende del caso específico. Si los lotes, si un lote está en un parque nacional, se sabe que y es de conocimiento público que está en un parque nacional, lógicamente eso afecta el precio. Pero además la Constitución Política de Costa Rica, en el artículo 129, dice que nadie puede alegar desconocimiento de la ley. O sea, ningún ciudadano de Costa Rica puede alegar que no conoce un decreto que crea un parque nacional. Es un principio básico constitucional. Y en estos casos no solo existe el principio constitucional, sino que existe prueba de que ellos conocían cuando compraron de que sus lotes estaban en un parque nacional. Y existen sellos y existe la escritura pública que dice que conoce y que...
Dr. Chavez, I think goes some way beyond my question. So, to evidence that's already been addressed. I was simply inviting you to speculate on the consequences on the value of the property from a declaration of public interest. But thank you, you've responded to that. Let me just make sure that my colleague, Mr. Van Wesser, doesn't have any questions.
No, I have no questions.
Well, Dr. Chavez, thank you very much indeed for assisting us, and you're excused from the witness chair. Thank you very much.
Gracias a usted.
Council, I think there are one or two minor issues that it would be helpful to deal with before we close for the day. I think that brings to the end the fact testimony of the witnesses from both sides. We move tomorrow to the expert witnesses, the valuation witnesses for each side. I would just like to clarify, I think, with counsel for the claimant. We sought clarification from you about the translation of a document that you had put into the record, and perhaps you could, that's the translation, I think, of the 2005 opinion, is it not? And you were going to just clarify that for us, whether you are going to provide us with the full English translation rather than just the 4 or 5 pages.
I'll stand to be corrected, but I believe that in the record there is a full English translation of the 2004 opinion, and that's, I believe, C1G, and we only did a partial translation of the 2005 because only the only difference is essentially the beginning of the document. So that was the basis for not translating both into full form. I can confirm that overnight.
Well, if you could confirm that overnight, but otherwise we understand that as we're between the two documents, we've got the full English translation of that document. And then for counsel for the respondents, just a point of clarification. There was some reference to a map earlier on. Can you tell us whether that map is in the record? We're not seeking to ask you to put it into the record if it's not, but we'd just like to know whether it is in the record.
For a point of clarification, what the map that Mr. Piedra was discussing is on the record, and that is Annex C to Respondent's Memorial on Jurisdiction and Counter Memorial on the Merits. That's the image. It's the second map on there, which is dated 2013. It's the first phase of the map that is requested by the Contraloría. So this is identifying the delimitation of the park. And there's what is ongoing is identifying the parcels on that park, and that's what's still yet to be concluded. And that is not on the record.
And is that map that Mr. Piedra referred to, which you've just identified, the same as the map as Dr. Jurado referred to, which he said is just waiting for publication?
No, they're two different stages, I guess. The first stage is identifying the park limits, so the boundaries, and that's what Mr. Piedra was discussing, which is complete. And what Mr. Jurado was discussing was it's the catastral map, which is identifying the properties that are located on top of that map. And that is still in process, and that is not on the record.
I see. Thank you very much. Let me just turn to Mr. Cantor, because I think he raised one or two questions about documents wanting clarification whether they were in the record. But have you got an answer to those?
I do not have an answer to those, so I'll ask them again. First, is there a full English translation of the report of the Contraloría in the record?
It was submitted by claimants.
The claimant's document is only a partial translation, Mr. Cantor.
Okay. And second, the chart reporting on the status of various actions called for under that report identified a 2013 expropriation manual. Is that in the record?
I do not believe that's on the record.
Thank you.
Just before we close,
Mr. President, I did want to make a note that I heard Ms. McCandless, and I'm not doubting she's testified accurately. I do want to look at the transcript last evening. This evening, I'm not sure that I understand her answers to be consistent with those on the record that were produced by the witnesses today. So I'll just check that overnight, if I may.
Well, I'm not quite sure what the issue is, but no doubt you'll come back to us tomorrow if there's anything that you want to raise with us. A couple of housekeeping matters for the next few days. Tomorrow we start off with the witness testimony of Mr. Hayden, and we'll start at 9:30 tomorrow, and we'll move from there to Mr. Kaczmarek. For Friday, this is really just to put counsel for both sides on notice, because I'd like your clarifications tomorrow. We put to you after your opening submissions, this is on Tuesday morning, I think 14 quite detailed questions. We're mindful of the fact that time is our time. It doesn't intrude into the 2 hours of closing time that each of you have got. So I'm just reflecting on how we arrange Friday. My proposal to you, but I'd like you to come back to us at the start of tomorrow just to clarify that this is convenient, is that instead of the morning session running from 9:30 through till 12, which was just intended to be the claimant's closing, that we would extend that by half an hour running through till 12:30, which will hopefully give you an additional period of time to respond to any questions. We would then have the lunch break from 12:30 through till 2 o'clock and extend the respondents' closing from 2 through till 5, which will give you a symmetry of timing to give you some additional time to respond to the questions. We would then take the half an hour coffee break, which is in the schedule, which I should just explain is the half an hour coffee break to allow us, the members of the tribunal, to reflect on any last minute formalities that we will want to address with you before we bring the hearing to a close, and then have a half an hour's worth of closing formalities or as required, which would bring us through till 6 o'clock. Now, what I would like you to reflect on is whether you think the the additional half an hour, both in the morning and the afternoon, is going to be sufficient for you both to deal with the questions that we put to you orally. If not, if you feel that we'll need some extra time, then we'll have to think about starting a little bit earlier, shortening the lunch break, and or ending a little bit earlier, which is the reason why I'm raising it with you now, so that you can reflect on it overnight and tell us tomorrow. So if you could just reflect on that. I know that claimants, you had flight plans, and this really then should put you on notice that flight plans are not going to work early on Friday evening. But let me just, before we close, invite counsel for both sides just to raise with us any issues that you think need to be raised of a procedural nature. So for the claimants, is there any issue that you'd like to raise with us?
Not this evening, Mr. President.
Mr. Alexandra.
Thank you, Mr. President. Two thoughts. One is, it's now 5 minutes past five, which means we have close to an hour. We left open the question that you asked yesterday, whether we want to address some of the questions on a preliminary basis today. We are prepared to do that, again, on a preliminary basis, without foregoing the opportunity that the tribunal is giving us on Friday. So the first thought is, would you like us to do that now? The second thought that I want to throw out is, tomorrow we have two experts. It may be that we may finish their examination early. Would you like us to also take that opportunity to, again, on a preliminary basis, address some of the questions? As you said, the questions are not few and are complicated. And today and tomorrow we may be able to clarify, at least on a preliminary basis, some of our answers, or outline them, or perhaps give answers that will give rise to additional questions. I don't know. But there is some time and some window of opportunity for that.
Thank you, Mr. Alexander. I think when we were reflecting yesterday on whether we should use the remaining period this afternoon for responses, as I indicated yesterday in closing, we were certainly open to that possibility. I understood from both parties, although this was not a discussion on the record, that if we were to have ended early in the afternoon, you would have liked to use the time. But as we've now got really 50 minutes, and in any event, we've been going for a long period, and we'd probably want to take a break, I think probably anticipating that we'd have half an hour simply to address questions probably doesn't make a great deal of sense. But I think we would be persuaded if the two parties were to agree, but otherwise I think we'd be inclined to draw this proceeding today to an end. As regards the timing tomorrow, well, we are to some extent going to be in both of your hands in terms of the length of the cross-examination. We've got some very detailed experts' reports on valuation. I think the tribunal would be undoubtedly content to have submissions from one or both of you in response to the questions that we put in tomorrow's session, to the extent that there is some free time. We hope that there will be some free time. But unless the two of you, as it were, instantly put your heads together and say that you'd actually like to use a remaining half an hour today to start to address, I'm taking it from Mr. Koper, who's shaking his head in the negative, that he would prefer not to proceed. And Mr. Alexandrov, I'm assuming that on that basis we should adjourn today. If we do end tomorrow with the expert testimony, leaving us with sufficient time for either or both sides to begin to answer the questions, I think we should proceed down that road. So let me suggest to both parties that do come prepared at least to use what time is available at the end of tomorrow to begin to answer questions. But that still leaves the question that I put to both of you at the outset, and that is, do you think an extra half an hour in the morning session and the afternoon session on Friday is going to give you an adequate amount of time to roll in your answers to our questions, or do you think that you will need additional time? I'm not asking for an immediate response to that. You can give me a response to that tomorrow morning. Please do.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, Working backwards, we're more than happy to take the tribunal's generous offer of some additional time for Friday, because we do believe that the questions are important and worth spending some additional time addressing them. So we take that opportunity, and I start backwards, because the answer to that question is, in at least from the perspective of respondent, quite an ambiguous. We understand the tribunal's concern that today we don't have sufficient time, so we don't insist. I was just throwing that thought out as a possibility. With respect to tomorrow, we'll be prepared to, again, I emphasize, on a preliminary basis and subject to further clarifications on Friday, to address at least some of the questions, and at least to a certain extent. So if we have the time tomorrow, and we understand that we don't know that yet today, but if we do have the time tomorrow, we would be willing and prepared, and again, I emphasize, on a preliminary basis at least, to address some of the tribunal's questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. If we do have the time tomorrow, we will take you up on that offer. Mr. Cooper.
Yes, Mr. President. Just offhand, it would occur to me that if we do capture time tomorrow, then we should revisit whether we need any extra time on Friday. But if we don't do that, I agree with my friend. I'll grab any offer for extra 30 minutes that is on the table. But if we each get time, then we should revisit the schedule on Friday.
Well, I'm happy to revisit that at the end of tomorrow, but you need to do some thinking overnight. I mean, in fact, the extension of the extra half an hour on Friday would mean that you would each have, I think, 2¾ hours, which would give you an additional 45 minutes on the two hours that has been allotted for closing. So really what I was trying to gauge was whether you thought that 45 minutes was enough additional time to do justice to the answers that you want to give to 14 questions, or whether you felt you needed more time than that. But really reflect on that. If there's anything that you want to say to me tomorrow morning before we start, please do so. Otherwise, we'll proceed on the basis that we've just discussed. If there's any additional time after the witness evidence tomorrow, we'll go to the questions and run that through into Friday. But we will plan to start Friday at 9:30 in the morning, running through till 12:30, and then again start after the lunch break at 2 o'clock, running through to 5. Mr. Alexandrov, you had a...
Just to address your question, Mr. President, and to do the math wrongly, but with some approximation, 45 minutes divided by 15, assuming the questions were 15, would mean 3 minutes per question, which, of course, is insufficient in our view. So if we understand that we may end up without any extra time tomorrow, in which case we'll probably take some time off of our closing to address the questions more extensively, which is why we hope that there will be some time tomorrow to do that.
Mr. Alexandrov, having been on, as it were, your side of the bar on numerous occasions, I'm very well aware that questions can somehow disappear off the agenda. So I was not asking you to do the addition and see that it was going to be 3 minutes a question, but let's work on that basis. Thank you very much. We'll adjourn for this evening, and we will begin again at 9:30 tomorrow morning. Thank you.